Hey guys, welcome back. Today we're going to be wiring up our sub panel. So we have two LV6548 inverters and we're going to be running them in 120/240 split phase feeding the sub panel. Let's take a closer look at the panel. You'll notice this panel has two main lugs. It's got the one on the left for the left bus bar and it's got one on the right for the right bus bar. This is your L1 or hot primary. And this is your L2 or hot secondary. One of these bus bars give you 120 volts and one of these bus bars give you 120 volts. Both of them together will give you 240 volts. A single slot breaker looks like this. And it's gonna only fill up one slot. So it's only gonna contact one of these bus bars. Like that. If I were to put it there, it would contact this bus bar and I would get power from this bus bar. If I were to put it on the next slot down, it would actually connect to this bus bar and get power from this bus bar because the bus bars are interleaved. They're like this. And the reason for that is when you fill out your panel going down, every other slot you're going to be hitting each side or each leg of the bus. So you'll be evenly distributing your loads. One will be here, one will be here, 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 like that. And that's to help evenly distribute the load across your panel. If you notice a dual slot bus bar like this, this is a 240 volt. It's going to have two legs, hot one and hot two. It's got two slots. This is going to take up two slots. So when you put this down, it's going to contact this bus bar and it's going to contact this bus bar. So it's going to get power from this one and power from this one separately. So together that'll be 240 volts. I got two grounding bus bars, one on the left and one on the right. And there's a neutral bus bar on the left and on the right. This neutral bus bar is bonded by this bus bar across the top. So essentially this whole section here, these golden screws coming up across the top and down. This whole thing is the neutral bus bar. And I installed an extra neutral lug on the left so it can accommodate the neutral coming in from the left inverter. And this neutral is going to accommodate the neutral coming in from the right inverter. This is a neutral ground screw. We're not going to use this. I'll explain more about the neutral ground bonding later. So normally your main feed wires would come in and they would come into these main lugs and feed your bus bar and then all your circuits would go out through your breakers. But in this case, I'm installing a main breaker and that's going to go right here. My mains will come in and go to this breaker and then essentially feed the bus bar that way instead of using the main. So we're not going to be using the main lugs right here. So the reason I organized my inverters in this fashion is so that the panel would remain clean and symmetric. So this will be the primary inverter. This will provide hot number one, or our primary hot. And it'll come in to the left side of the panel and feed the left bus bar here. And all the wiring will stay pretty much on the left side of this panel for that inverter. The inverter on the right will come in and come through here and it'll feed the right bus bar and this will be our secondary hot and all the wiring will pretty much stay on the right side of the panel, so it's very easy to look at and understand how it's wired if it's laid out in this fashion. So let's take a look at what we got. These are our mains. This will carry the power from our inverters to the sub panel. This is 4-gauge wire. We have our primary hot, our secondary hot, and our neutral. And we're going to be pairing this with a 70 amp double pole breaker. And we have number 6 ground wire. You'll definitely need a number 2 square drive screwdriver when you're dealing with a panel. You might want to pick up some ring nut wrenches. Cable cutters and some coaxial cutters for the large cables. Our liquid tight, our seal tight connectors and some tape. All right, so the first order of business is wiring up our mains. We'll use the black and the white for our inverter on the right, and we'll use another white for neutral and our red for the inverter on the left. So before we start, I am not an electrician. I do a lot of research and I watch a lot of videos. Thank you, Will, and thank you, Lithium Solar, and thanks to my good buddy who's a lifelong electrician here in Vegas. This is 4-gauge wire, and the manual calls for 4-gauge wire. I know a lot of people like to use 6-gauge wire for the mains, because, well, 4-gauge is questionable whether it fits, but it actually does fit, barely. It scrapes the sides of the connector, but it does actually fit. So yeah, you can use 4, but once you get to 4, it's a little bit difficult to use, but that's what it calls for, and that's what you really should be using if you're going to be running these things like full power all the time. But in most cases, you can use 6-gauge with a 60 amp breaker. It's actually pretty common. So, but it does work. All right, so along with my mains, I'll be running this green number 6 ground wire. I'm using a number 6 for the ground and not a number 4 for this reason. These grounding bus bars will only accept a number 6. That's the largest cable you can actually fit into them without installing a lug like this to accommodate a larger cable. Second reason is you don't need to run equal gauge ground wire. You can run a smaller gauge ground wire because ground is not a current carrying wire. Okay, let's talk about ground neutral bonding, when and where to do it. Just like any household appliance plugged into your house's main electrical service panel, the inverters also get their ground neutral bond via the AC or grid input, specifically from the ground and neutral AC input wires. Take a look at this clip from a previous video. The third feature is grounding for your AC output. As you can see, the ground LED on the AC output power strip is not lit. When I plug in the AC input to the grid, we will have grounding. And now our AC devices plugged into the power strip have proper grounding. In short, when connected to the AC in or grid input, you do not use a ground neutral bond connection in your sub panel. But what if you're running your inverters completely off grid and never intend to hook up grid power for bypass or AC charging? At that point, you can opt to have the ground neutral bond inside your sub panel. If you do, be sure to remove the ground neutral bond screw inside each inverter. Be sure to consult your manual or manufacturer of your equipment before doing so. This panel comes with a ground neutral bonding screw. Once installed, it connects the ground bus bars to the neutral bus bars. To install it, you simply put it in this hole and you screw it in to the chassis. Once that's done, you'll have your neutrals connected to your grounds. I will not be using this. So how is bonding handled when we have grid power connected via AC in, since we cannot have a local neutral ground bond when grid power is connected? Each inverter has a built-in automatic transfer switch. When grid power is connected via the ATS switch, the internal bond is broken. At that point, the ground neutral bond is handled by our main service panel. When the inverters switch back to battery or off-grid mode, the internal bond is restored and the grid connection is broken. I'll post a link to a video that explains ground neutral bonding in detail in the description below. Let's review. Your main service panel already has a ground neutral bond. The inverters have internal bonding screws. This bond is managed by the internal ATS switch. When using grid power for bypass or AC charging, the bond is broken. Ground neutral bond must be established in a single place only. This is typically done nearest the main service disconnect. If your system is totally off-grid, no AC input, you can choose to place the bond in your sub-panel. You must remove the bonding screws inside your inverter before doing so. Okay, I got a 1.5-foot piece of 1-inch conduit. You're going to really like working with this stuff, guys. It's really easy to work with. Take your connector, put it on there. I'm gonna go underneath these fingers here, because when you put that on, it's gonna clamp those fingers on there and clamp it on. Just re-put it on just like that. I can put our 90 on, because we're gonna run our wires through our panel first, and then we're gonna make our connections to the inverter last. And feed your wires through that elbow, because that's the hardest part. Put that on. Strap this down here later.
Make sure to back out the screws all the way first. Make sure you be very careful when you're working with these terminals. They're not very strong. But what happens when you do a bend near the end of the wire, a hard bend, you're gonna end up getting the wires like this. So we're gonna have to bend it first and then cut the wires. In that case, we're gonna make sure to strip extra wire back so that we can cut it. Okay, there's a trick to this wire. It's gonna bend like that. Spin it around a couple times. Utility knife. Looks like it's coming right off, all right. Don't go too much because you'll scar the metal. You can actually feel it. It'll first be smooth because that's cutting through the insulation. Once you feel like a bump, that's the blade hitting the metal. So, okay, we're gonna connect our black to our line, our L. That's gonna be the one on the left. Once it's in the conduit, holy crap. Here it goes. Wow. Okay, next we can just lightly tighten these down. That is in there so tight by itself that you almost don't need to tighten these down, but of course you want to tighten them down, obviously. Copper's soft, right? So it's gonna sort of, you know, it's gonna squish over time. So make sure when you tighten them up today and come back the next day, tighten them up again, and maybe a week later, and then tighten them up again to make sure you get a nice solid connection. There, actually. Oh, there it goes. There we go, now it's in there. Okay, it's all good. Time to wire the panel. So exciting. These are insulated screwdrivers, so good for 1,000 volts. Now our ground is done. Next we can do our neutral. That's perfect. Now this lug came with a flathead. But you can see this one over here came with an Allen. You can always get way more torque with an Allen, so I switched out the little screw for the Allen instead. Now we can do our primary line or hot. Each side of this breaker only has to carry about 50-55 amps, like as far as it goes in, right? So I gotta cut that off. I can't believe how shallow that is. Just like that. There's your breaker. Be sure to use your insulated screwdrivers. Okay. So after looking at this, I realized that I want to have this inverter feeding the left bus bar and this inverter on the right feeding the right bus bar. When I looked at the breaker, I had the wire in here in the bottom slot. And the bottom slot actually contacts the breaker on the right. So I had to move the wire from the bottom slot to the top slot so it contacts this bus bar. So this slot will energize that one when the breaker's on. Okay, nothing happens here. If we put it on the bottom slot there, that's that one. All right, we got that inverter done. Now it's time to do the other inverter. For the second inverter, we're going to use red for the secondary hot. We're going to again use the green and the white neutral and ground. Nice and tight. Okay. Sure glad I went to 1 inch. I was going to try to use 3/4. No way, man. Be careful with these connectors, they're easy to cross thread. I tell you what, it's like surgery. The biggest problem you're going to have is keeping the strands compressed tightly together. That's the hardest thing. If you can get the strands compressed together, it will slide in there with, you know, a good amount of force, but not insane amount. So that's the main key. Okay. That number six goes in so easy. When you're in there, as long as you're making these connections here, also check the top connections here. I found that the inverter wires coming from the inverter to these top connectors here were also, a couple of them were pretty loose. So just double check all the connections. Okay, all we have to do now is wire the sub panel for inverter number two. Need a little more cranking power, Biff. Because there's so much room on this lug, there's like, I can almost put two of these in there, almost. One and a half. That'll give us more contact area. Look at these screws. It's kind of beveled to a point, see? So it's not the greatest. Get the neutral in there. All right. Nice neutral. Tighten it up. I'm really irritated that I couldn't find a lug that points up, because I wanted to have this wire come up and around so it looks perfectly symmetric. See? I messed up everything. Alright, our neutral's done. Now we can do our secondary hot. Guys, now that our mains are wired up, let's do a quick recap. Okay, so our black line comes in and goes to our top slot on our double probe breaker. Our white neutral comes in and goes to the left lug on the neutral bus bar. Our green ground comes in and goes to our left grounding bar on the left side of the panel. Just like the left side, same on the right side, except we're going to have a red hot, primary, secondary hot. Secondary hot comes in to our bottom slot on our two-pole breaker. Our neutral comes in and comes in here to our neutral lug on our neutral bus bar on the right side. And the ground comes in to our grounding bar on the right side of the panel. It's not that hard, guys.